Okay, hello everybody again. Last class before the midterm. I have not prepared the exam, so we can talk about the exam later. But I have an idea, but I have not written anything about this. Phylogenetic trees. Well, as I said last time, I'm not a big fan of multiple alignment, and in consequence, I'm not a big fan of this. I mean, not different. I never had a real need for phylogenetic trees, so I am not an expert. In fact, I had to learn a lot to prepare this class, but well, that is why we teach. Someone has to learn, at least, if not the student, at least the professor learns something. So essentially, the subtitle of today is the time machine. No, we are trying to build a time machine. We think that the context that we are putting ourselves in, the idea that we have a bacteria. Well, this is a separate paragraph. Okay, I may edit the text at the same time. So yeah, I made some errors in the text. So. Save. Anyway, if the organism that you have an organism that they called here X evolved eventually into two new organisms. They essentially pointed that organisms that are descending of the same ancestor, they share a lot of the sequence. That is the basic idea that we are going to use. Essentially, if we are able to see everything, you have an organism, and at some moment, for some replication error or something that happened during the DNA replication, you get a new variant. And this survive, let's say, and you get today an organism that I'm calling A, another called X, and another called B, a different event. Okay? That is the idea. You can find this A, X, and B that are closely related, and you find the sequence. But the real problem came when the X organism died. Somewhere in the time, they were extinct for many reasons. Essentially, well, you know, extinction happened. Some species appear, some species disappear. So we only see A and B, and we don't see X. And we want to find how A and B are related beyond that they are similar. So what was X, essentially, is the question, or something like that, like how A and B are connected to the rest of the living organism. So the time machine question is how to reconstruct the original tree given the sequence that we see today. I call modern or contemporary the thing. They're not necessarily modern because, I mean, if you do archaeology, you will find sequences that are thousands of years old. But I mean the sequence that you have today, okay? So to answer that question, we need just a quick look at how evolution works. In fact, I have a video here that I didn't want to put, but you can share. Let me share this in the chat. I prefer that you watch directly in your computer because I think it will be better quality than if if I show in my screen, it will not look so nice. It's a couple of minutes, so take a look. Okay. Yes, no? Yeah, take a look at the video. Well, I can play it here also. Okay, I'm turning off the camera in the meantime, okay? Eso. Tell me when you finish the video, okay? Okay, you are looking at the camera now, so I'm guessing that you are finished. But you didn't say, tell me when you finish. So, comments? Any comments? Not everybody at the same time. Comments? Say something, come on. You just saw evolution in your screen. I mean, not
Actually,
every day.
I have a biological question.
Go ahead, ask it. I mean, I don't have necessarily ask it, but I don't have answer, but I have questions also.
How bacteria didn't die in a couple of days and it evolved? Like, it was in a high concentration of antibiotics, but it survived
antibiotic
couple
resistance.
Days. And okay, I know the resistance, but how did it survive like 2 days or 3 days, maybe?
But remember that in the border here in the screen, you see in the side, the initially they don't have antibiotic in the side. This dark blue, they grow naturally. It's just a petri dish without any antibiotic. Then in the second strip, you have antibiotic. And so eventually, after some days, some of the bacteria mutate enough to cross. I mean, they are mutating constantly. And eventually, some of them, most of them die. Most of the mutations are lethal. Most of time people die. Well, me people, but cells, most of cells die. But if one doesn't die, it survives and it grows. And it grows because it is resistant to antibiotic in that concentration. And you see there is even some branching, and these branches die. So there are many branches that don't go anywhere. They evolve enough to survive in the new environment. They may evolve back and lose the antibiotic resistance, and they die. And eventually, they keep changing until they are able to grow in the higher concentration. And more time passes, the more and more chance they have to create, just by random, a kind of a variant that is resistant to the antibiotic. And I'm not even considering plasmid and things. This is just explaining. You can explain this just assuming DNA mutation, Okay. And you see there is a tree. That's kind of the point here, that it is easy to see that this will become a tree. Okay, why people like tree? Because essentially if you start with one and this start duplicating, and the duplication have different lives, some survive, some die. This is the part that we observe here, no? The one that survived at the end of the process, no? So, fine. So, okay, I made a short talk about evolution, but I'm not an expert, and you can comment anything that you want here. I would like to see your comments. But essentially, the idea that we have behind is that mutations happen, that DNA replication is not 100% perfect, and mutations can happen and do happen, in fact, very often. You know, there is a lot of mechanisms that protect DNA for not degrading too much. Like there is some kind of when the DNA replicates and then the DNA polymerase is filling, there is another enzyme that is kind of error correcting. Like if something is not matching, if they are paired wrongly, they fix it. And then you have all this telomerase and things that are kind of protecting DNA that essentially we know that every time human cells divide, they are not 100% fine. They're not 100% the same. And eventually that is, well, I'm not enough for sure, but apparently cancer is something that happens after that many, many replications. You accumulate so much damage in your DNA that DNA stop working. So cancer is kind of an evolution of your internal cells, no? So, but for us, for our the explanation, we are happy to know that this is something like substitution, insertion, deletions, and reorganization. Now, reorganizations are a kind of major event, like a completely change of the shape of the DNA. They are kind of the complete genome is changing order. And that is harder to see in this context. Here we're going to focus mostly on substitution. Now, the question, the big question is, how much substitution we have, and there is a tendency to say that there should not be too much because we don't see too many variation. How much variation we expect to see, and the point is that not all mutations are viable. Not all mutations are good for the cell. Most of the mutations are I don't know if most, but I will guess that most of the mutations are bad. You change something that is important for a protein. If you change the key amino acid, then the protein is not working and the cell doesn't survive. And the most critical one is the ribosomal genes. You know, ribosomal genes do their action essentially by the sequence. They are not translated to amino acids, so they are much more sensitive to any change. So if you change the wrong, if through replication, one of the nucleotides change, then probably the cell is going to die. So most of the mutations are lethal. Then there is another point that there are some the first idea is that mutations are either good or bad for you, for the cell. So you either get better condition or worse condition. But there is another point of view that the neutral theory that essentially says that most mutations, I mean, most are fatal, but the ones that are accepted, most of them do nothing. They don't improve your life. They don't make your life worse. For example, in general terms, if you change the third nucleotide in every codon, you will essentially code for the same protein, the same amino acid. You can change a lot without having an impact in the protein shape. Some may be more efficient than others, so maybe there is a more low-term effect, but from the protein that you are making the same protein. So you can have mutations that don't have any effect. Or if you mutate in the, especially in eukaryotes, you have these intergenic regions that are huge. You can have a lot of change that doesn't do anything. So, but the point is that this can be observed. So in a first model, essentially, you can think, and I think it's enough for us to think like that, that you will have mutations, essentially randomly, and after a while, some of the mutation will be accepted, and not all. If they are not accepted, then that nucleotide is super important. If it's not so important, it can change. So we can essentially measure the importance of every nucleotide depending on the times, the number of times that we see mutating. Now there are other effects that are maybe important in the big picture. That the first question of a mutation is if you survive or not. If the mutation is fatal or lethal, the cell will not survive. But if you have an environment where many cells can survive, not all will survive with the same success. Let's say the replication rates may be different. So essentially, I'm thinking, well, you can think in like, if you have children, your genes survive, your species survive. If you don't have children, then you don't survive. I mean, eventually, you need to replicate. And if you, the thing that we see in the long term are things that replicate. If any cell doesn't replicate, or doesn't replicate very fast, or they're growing slowly. Imagine that you have a container with two kinds of bacteria, and one is growing faster, and the other is growing slower. So both can survive. If you have a lot of food, both can survive. But if the food starts to finish, the one that is growing faster has more chance to survive. So that is what people call a bottleneck. If you have a kind of limited resources or a particularly hard environment, you need to, how can I say, some of the organisms will survive and some will survive with less rate, and eventually some get extinct. So, and this is, I want to emphasize, this is a second order effect. At the first level, if the protein is mutated in a wrong way, then the new cell just die. There is another level and you have cells that can survive, but given the environment, they survive less. And eventually they get extinct. That is what people call fitness. And there is a nice theory. If you have time one day, take a look at something that's called fitness landscape. It's a very beautiful theory. But the basic point is that different organisms may have different chances of surviving given the characteristic. Let's say that some cells are more efficient at capturing energy from the environment. So in the long term, they are going to have an advantage. In the short term, they may not be very different, but in the long term, they will have an advantage. What else? Coevolution. There's a next complication essentially with sex. When you have sexual reproduction, there is another factor that to pass your genes to the next generation, you need to find someone, you need to mate with someone. And if you look at any kind of documentary about animals, insects, or I don't know, flies, or many things, there is a lot of point that how some characteristics are passed to another generation. There is maybe the most classical extremes, you know, the peacock. You know, the peacock, this bird with very colorful feathers, the males are very colorful. In birds in general, males tend to be very big and show a lot of things, like a signaling for the female to be attracted and to mate. So The interesting thing is this, because let's say, I'm going to say in a very simple way, but let's say that people or animals want to mate with someone which is beautiful, let's say. So I want to have children with the most beautiful one, whatever is beautiful. But then what is beautiful? For example, in some insects, the males have like the beetle, the rhinoceros, the rhino beetle, they have big horns. Or you have it also with the moose or some kind of, you know, this animal with big like antelopes, okay? So apparently female preferred to mate with males that have big horns. Why? Nobody knows. But the point is that the evolution of the shape of the male is paired with the evolution of the good taste for the females. Let's say that there are two things happening at the same time. For one side, the shape of the males or females evolve, and in the other side, the attraction, what you find beautiful or not beautiful, or attractive or not attractive, is also evolving. So there is nothing intrinsically defined of what is beautiful or not beautiful. I mean, look at the insect. The insects and even mammals tend to mate with or birds. For example, there is a point that in some birds, females choose to mate with males that are able to do beautiful nests. Or they seem beautiful, or they, I don't know, they have bigger feathers. So something very crazy that is not obviously, maybe, or maybe not, but it's not obviously connected to survival. And my point is, these two things evolve together, the physical aspect, but also the behavior of choosing a mate is also something that is also evolving. So that makes the analysis of this problem much, much more complicated. And there is a particular point of evolution that I wanted, I found this kind of African story. Essentially saying that when you have predator and prey, when you have hunters and animals that are being hunted, they both evolve together. You can think predator prey is also what happened with the pandemics. If you have a virus that is very aggressive, if a virus is very, very aggressive, then it kills everybody and then they don't survive. Apparently, Ebola is like that. You know, Ebola is a very deadly virus. And every time that we have Ebola, most people die very quickly. It's very, very bad. But then Ebola dies because it kills everybody. There is no host. So, yeah. So when lions evolve to run because gazelles evolve to run. And you cannot explain lions without gazelles, and you cannot explain gazelles without lions. They evolve together. They co-evolve. And in fact, we one of the most everyday thing that we observe, everyday example of this is the fruit that we eat, you know. Corn, Mr., you know, it doesn't grow native. To the one that we eat, you need to open it. The seeds are inside the leaves. If you don't harvest corn, it will not grow naturally. You need to open it. So corn is something that grow with us. People, especially people in corn is Mexican and Peruvian, is Latin American. And people in America evolved this thing. They choose the small ones, the small corns, and they choose the best ones. And through generation, they got the one that we have today. Same with potatoes, same with tulips, apples, what else, bananas. All these plants, all this fruit that we eat are not natives, are things that we humans chose. So we like them and we make them grow the way that we like. Essentially, we know that we can change the plants. If we choose the plant that we like, we can make them evolve. And humans have been choosing plants and making plants evolve for millennia. In fact, there is another example that you may have at home is dogs. Maybe cats also, but I'm not so sure. But dogs clearly are very different from other mammals. So if you see wolves that are very close to dogs, they have a behavior that is very different. So apparently, 10 or 20,000 years ago, people start keeping some wolves and selecting the wolves that are less aggressive. And after a while, after some generation, they become dogs. So dogs are animals that evolved with us. And we did, you can find all the kind of this archaeological register, but they are clearly things that don't exist. Even cows, cows that we have today are not native. They don't exist in nature. We created them, we made them evolve. But that is the general framework, and you probably can tell me much more things about evolution. But for the purpose of our class, I'm going to talk about, let's say, molecular evolution. That to make it very simple, I'm thinking that we are going to look at one gene. So here I remember one of my professors always insisted that the only gene that you can strictly speak about phylogeny is the 16S or 18S, the ribosomal genes, which are usually the genes used to define what is the name, species identity. So some other people argue that you should not only look at this gene, you should also look at the housekeeping gene, like 10 or 12 genes that are present in every organism, and they since they are housekeeping, they cannot change very much, and they are good markers. By the way, if you want to identify the phylogeny, it is kind of obvious that you have to choose something that changes, but not too much. If you have something that changes every day, it will not be a good marker. I mean, let's say you don't identify people by the clothes. You can change your clothes every time, but it doesn't change your identity. You have to find identity on stuff that doesn't change very much. But on the other side, it should change something. It cannot be too fixed. It cannot be too variable. You have to find something that changes just enough. And these ribosomal genes are good to identify organism. In some other cases, people like to do kind of a phylogenetic of a particular protein or a particular gene. You have a protein, like the one that we saw last week, this dehydrogenase and different organisms, and you would like to see how they become to be what they are, how they cluster together. But just to fix the idea, we are going to talk about sequences that are not too big. We remember, we need to do a multiple alignment, and too long sequences are a problem. If you are lucky, you get all the nucleotides of the 16S. And in the 16S is good, as I say, because most of the mutations are lethal. I want to know if you know this word, lethal. Lethal means fatal, but it's kind of more lethal weapon. I don't know. It's more lethal, I guess, is Greek, and fatal is more like Latin. But it's a word that people use, lethal deletion, lethal mutation. So
it's biological use.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. Exactly. Come kind of in biology and in movies, people say lethal. You know the movie Lethal Weapon? Like, Mel Gibson. Well, anyway, so well, the 16S has a good characteristic that is kind of very conservative, but it change enough between organisms that allows us to use it as a marker of the organism. Maybe you can take all the operon. And the other thing that we are going to assume here is asexual reproduction. I mean, I'm thinking in bacteria, okay? If you try to do this with sexual reproduction, things get very, very complicated. So maybe I should put a slide here, but we want to speak about trees, okay? We want to make trees. So what is a tree? A tree is a network. It's a particular part of network. I always think that we should have and maybe we do at the end of this course, we should have a little class about networks, because kind of everything in biology sooner or later becomes some kind of network, like metabolic networks or regulation networks. In ecology, there's some kind of, what they call, I don't know, ecological networks. I'm not sure. But networks are again and again in biology. And in particular, there is a part of network that we call trees, like taxonomy, for example, is a tree. Phylogenetic trees are trees. And there is something else called the ontology. Well, anyway, so just to have some definitions. So you remember that we have nodes and links or branches, if you like. And there is an important distinction. When you have a tree, there is some nodes that are inside, essentially nodes that have children. These are called internal nodes. And if they don't have children, these are leaves. So just to fix the idea. Everybody understand, no? When we say leaves are a kind of, in this case, they will correspond to organisms that you see today. And the internal nodes will be the ancestors, okay, that we don't see today, okay? That is the time machine part. So there is an important distinction that people make. Some trees, the most of the trees that we want, they have a root. So what we have in our mind that you have an initial organism and then start splitting. So there is a kind of the grandpa or the super grand, the great grandpa. Sometimes it's useful to think about this like a family tree. So you have one element, and you have the siblings, the brothers and sisters, and then you have the father or the parent, and the grandparent and the grandparent. You can think of the cousins and something like that. Speaking in terms of family, is useful just to fix the idea. No, it's not technically correct, but you get the idea. So. Rooted trees, essentially, they have a point that you start from the root and you have arrows pointing down, like from the arrow go from father to, there's an arrow pointing from father to children or maybe from children to parents. Well, whatever, but there is an asymmetric relation. I mean, parent and children are not the same. There is an order, okay? So, the arrow starts from the root and the point to the leaves. I think I made my plot backward, but we can fix that later. But in many cases, we are going to have this point that since we have the sequence today, we don't know, when we compare two sequences, we can only say that they are different, but you cannot easily say that there is one before the other. So many methods will produce trees that are unrooted. They don't have a root. I will show you a couple of graphics. In fact, I have in a couple of slides, I will show you a graphic, okay? So, two kinds of trees, trees with root and trees without root. How you solve that point? What people do is that when you build a tree, you intentionally put one sequence that you know is very distant. Like, let's say, if I am comparing mammals, these proteins from mammals, I take the same protein in insect or in plants. One sample that is very distant from the other. That is very distant, you know that since it's very distant, it's going to be connected to the inner group only through the common ancestor. It's a way to point to where is the common ancestor. So let me show you a little drawing that I did. I did this. So an unrooted tree looks like this, okay? So you know that A and B are joined together and there is some common ancestor. And then C and D are also joined together and this ancestor, but you don't know where these things start. You don't have any reason to say, okay, A is closer to the root than the others. But there is no root. So what people do when they build a tree, they include intentionally something else, this A that is, or E, I don't know, this E that is distant from everybody, that you know from biological reasons, like you choose the sample intentionally to be different from the rest. And then essentially you pick from the E, you pull from there, and then everything gets in order and you get this rooted tree, okay? So since you know that this is the out group, you know that it's going to be connected and this is the root of the tree. You put A essentially kind of to pull everything and get the root of the tree. So you will find that most people recommend that when you do this multiple alignment, and if you want to make a tree, you need to include an out group, okay? Now, another comment about the mathematical language, at least the point that you get is that different people use different language for the same things. So, and since I am first an engineer and then a mathematician, I learn both languages and I get confused. So you will find me saying a thing with different, using different words from the same thing. When I learn the thing, I learn in computer networks. You know, so in a computer network, you have nodes that are connected by links. And sometimes you have a link that have one direction and we call them arrows. But then I go to the mathematical course and they tell me they are not networks, they are graphs. And they are not nodes, they are vertices, and they are not links, they are edges, and they're not arrows, they are arcs, okay? So if you any moment catch me speaking in different language, you have here is the dictionary, the glossary that will allow you to change from one to the other, okay? Just a couple of comments. People always speak about networks, the social network, but in Facebook, they speak about graph. Facebook, they provide several tools for analyzing the social network and it's called the graph tool. So this is graph. By the way, graph is not the same as a graphic, okay? I know that in every day we say graph to make a plot or to make a graphic of something. Graph technically means network, okay? And maybe I should also say that since Facebook exists and people start working with social networks, then a lot of technical and theoretical tools have been created in the last, I don't know, 20 years, 10 years maybe, that allow to work with big networks. So somehow Facebook helped science in the development of tools to analyze big networks. So I know some people, in fact, I think it's some friend of mine that are taking, they say the social network of bacteria, trying to find the interaction between bacteria. We have today tools that we didn't have 10 years ago, and these tools are going to exist, and you are going to live in a world where these tools exist. In fact, I don't know if you read, but and I, in fact, I didn't read in detail, but there was a new this week that Google got a successful result with the protein folding program, with artificial intelligence for finding protein folding. That can be a game changer, you know? That can mean that if you have a big computer, you are able to understand protein like nobody else before. So you may live in a completely different environment. If people are able to understand proteins, I mean, if you have today the capacity to understand protein and that capacity improves in the next 10 years, at the same rate that improved in the last 10 years, Your work is going to be completely different from my work. You will work in an environment that is hard to imagine today. So yeah, lucky you. Okay, let's get to some more philosophy. In fact, there is only one word that I want to say. The point that we want to be careful here is that we can draw the same tree in different ways. Okay, you can make it upside down or change the order of the leaves. You know, there are many ways to draw the same thing. So obviously, the tree, there is an essence. The important part of the tree is not how you draw it. Okay, the important part of the tree is what it is, and the what it is kind of the relationship. Who is connected to who? That is called topology. Topology in general means like what is the logic of connections. For example, when you take the metro, you may see in the metro, in the time that we take a metro, you may see in the over the door there is a map of the network of the metro network of all the stations. Okay, and it's a straight line. Obviously, the metro is not going in a straight line. If you see in the satellite, if you take a picture, you see the metro is doing many, many, many waves. They have many curves. But at the abstract level, the topology of the network of the metro stations is that you start from, I don't know, Jönköping, and then you go to Västnyjaled, and then you go to, what is Halic? And then Shishane, and then Taksim, and so. And these are the important part of that network is who comes first and who comes later. The distances here are not important. The shape is not important. The only important thing in the for this model is who is connected to who. Okay. And then there is a second part that we get here is the length of each part, branch, okay? Not how to draw it. Any question? No? Okay, so according to what I learned this week, there are essentially three approaches for this. And in fact, it reminds me, if we have time and people are interested, there is some I know a professor in Koch University who knows this thing very well. We can ask him to make a talk later, but later, okay? If you are interested in this thing, we can get a talk. Essentially, the three approaches are this: maximum parsimony. And I want to know if you know the word parsimony. You know the word parsimony? It's important. The basic idea of parsimony, the parsimony principle, is like you want to choose, if you have many alternatives, you want to choose the simple one. In fact, I want to show you in a minute let me show you. So here are the sequence that you get. You get ge, te, te, ge. So you have two ways to explain this. One is that you say that initially you have a ge, and you get one mutation here, and that is why you get t and t here. And the other way to explain this is that you have two mutations that are independent. You see these two trees have different topology. The connections are different. And in the second tree, you need two mutations independent. And in the first, you need only one. So the idea of parsimony is that the first tree requires less mutation than the second tree. Okay? And there is a general principle. I mean, this is, of course, a criteria, is that if you have more than one explanation, you have several explanations for the same phenomena, The one that we prefer, the one that we normally accept as the scientific explanation, is the one that has less, the simplest one, the less step, less part.
It's called Occam's razor, right?
Occam's razor, yeah. The Occam, yeah. The other name that people use is the Occam razor. Occam was someone living like 1,000 years ago. And he essentially said the idea that if we have many options, we should be parsimony. Parsimony is like, how can I tell it? Maybe you should look in the dictionary, but it's kind of being modest, being low profile. It's kind of something like low profile or going slow, going not to be big, like to go yavash yavash. So there is this idea. It kind of makes sense, especially in the context of scientific method, that you want to say, okay, this is what we observe. This is our observation, our experiment, our experimental data. And the tree is the model that explains how we got to get this thing. And from these two models, the parsimony principle is that we should take which is the simple one, the one that has less change. Then the second one is, so the way to do this, essentially you have to see all the trees, you have to explore all the trees and count how many change you need, how many hypotheses you need to do, and choose the one that is most parsimonious. So essentially, if you have a tree, you can count how many evolution events, how many mismatch, how many polymorphism we need to have, how many mutations we need to have. Okay. And so essentially we have to, in paper it's very easy, you have to see how the tree. The problem is, as you can imagine, the number of tree is huge. Well, they found the number like n to the power of n minus 2. So in practice, like if you have more than 10 leaves, you cannot do. It is only work for very small trees. If you have too many, you have to do something. You have to do something clever. So something clever is like there is some idea that you can quickly know that some trees are going to be bad. There is kind of a shortcut. The technique is called branch and bound. That essentially, you have some idea that there are some groups of tree that is not worth testing. There's some strategy to look quickly, at least. One option is like people do sampling, like you choose randomly and hope to see the best. If there are billions of trees, you take only 1 million and you see the best in this 1 million, something like that. The other problem with the parsimony methods is that sometimes people found that they don't work very well. How can you test this? Since we don't have the original sequence, we don't have a time machine, we have to create a fake environment. It's like we simulate the evolution in the computer. We start with a sequence and we simulate mutation rate at some with some frequency. We mutate some, we make insertion, we create fake sequences like descending. So we can make our own ecosystem with an original ancestor and different descendant. And then we can see if, I will wake you up. This sounds very much like an exam question. No. Ah, yeah, they wake up, okay. This sounds very much like an exam question. Like we simulate a lot of sequences and we want to align them and see what happened. What people found is that in some cases, not always, of course, there are many cases that they work well, but they are, first, they are expensive. And second, there are some cases in which the real tree is here and the maximum parsimony tree is very different. And the other problem is that they say that the statistical inconsistency, no, I never tried this, so well, we can try maybe in an exam. So if you add more sequences, you, like you have, I don't know, 10 sequences and you get a tree, and you add one more and the tree kind of get completely different. And that can happen. Kind of people don't like them. I mean, you see that the problem is so complex that you have to choose how to measure these things. So the maximum parsimony sounds good, but people are kind of disappointed. So the one that people really like is something called maximum likelihood. Now, likelihood is a funny word that I hope we can talk more later, because it's again about probabilities. So essentially you say, okay, we have, instead of looking what is the tree with less simple explanations, we want to see which is the tree that is most probable. And for measuring the probability, we need to have a model of evolution, a probabilistic model. And that is the problem, that there are different models. Evolution can, and there can be different models of evolution in different, I mean, evolution can happen in a different way in different places. You can have different environment that evolution happen at different rates, or the environment and pressure can be different. And again, we need to look at all the trees. So it is still expensive in the sense that you need to test for many, many trees. And you also need the point that you need more hypotheses. So the tools that, well, this is something that people like a lot, but as you see, you need more hypotheses. So the tool that I see that people use is, well, the third alternative is called the distance method. So I'm, okay, it's kind of early for a break, but again, so I want to show you the first, I don't know if it will be a good idea, but let's see. Let's see how much we can do before a break, because I see people with small eyes and they're holding the face so they don't fall. People need coffee. But okay, but just to fix the idea, we have the multiple alignment, and you have the sequence one to another, and you can calculate the distance, like the number of mismatch. Okay, here we have, after the alignment, that is important. This you can do this only after the multiple alignment. The input here is the multiple alignment, okay? After everything is aligned, then you can compare everything to everything, each one to each one, and you count how many mismatch, for example, or the percentage of mismatch, if you like. So here is an example that I took from Wikipedia. You can check it in Wikipedia if you like. And evidently, each sequence is equal to itself, so they have zero mismatch. And then you have the number of mismatch, and the basic point is that this method, you calculate this matrix and then you forget about the sequence. You only care about how many mismatch you have, not where they are. The other two methods, maximum parsimony and maximum likelihood, you need to keep all the sequences. You need to see where are the mismatches, where are the changes. In this case, we don't care. Okay, so they kind of need more resources, they need less resources, therefore, they can handle bigger problems. That is why people like distance method, because you can handle bigger problems. So let me go briefly, because this is something that I used to teach in the computing course, and it can be used in another context. This is an idea that is, if you like, a little about machine learning. You start with this matrix, okay? So okay, before going, I want to, 1 second. Everybody understand what is this matrix, no? Do you have any question about this matrix? This matrix, since it's a distance, there's something that we can say that will always happen. First, The diagonal is going to be zero. So you don't need to draw it. Many people don't even take the diagonal because it's always zero by definition. You are equal to yourself. Second, the distance from A to B is always going to be the distance from B to A. Going from one to the other, the number of mismatches is going to be the same. Okay? Therefore, the upper triangle is equal to the lower triangle. Or if you want to say, the matrix is symmetrical. So you will find that some people don't draw all these lower parts. Some people draw only the upper triangular part. Because you save space, you save memory. You are not saying the same thing two times. So yeah, people do this thing. Okay, you will find that some people, instead of showing this matrix, they show A to B and V to A, and not the lower line or the. You kind of save the first row, the first column, and all the diagonal and so. Okay, second point is that at least in this level, distance are always positive. Okay, because you are counting the number of mismatch and they cannot be negative. Okay, now you may find later that you can do the same with any other kind of distance every time that you compare. I mean, for example, the same logic that we use here is what people did for taxonomy. You have physical attributes like feathers or wings or if you swim, you live in the sea, you cold blood, hot blood, a series of attributes. And then you can compare animals and you know that, I don't know, falcons and doves are more similar than falcons and fish because they share more attributes. And therefore you can group them together and do the clustering and do the taxonomy based on that. So this is what we call hierarchical clustering. At least I know as hierarchical clustering. But please remember that there are two kinds of hierarchical clustering. And I am starting with the simple one that is called WPMG, progressive grouping. With the median average, something like that. So you start, the idea is this, you start with the matrix and you look which of these numbers is the smallest. This number is this one. So A and B are the most similar ones. Okay, the most similar ones we are going to group together. By the way, you may remember that last week we say that we, to make the multiple alignment, we make a guide tree. A tree that guides how to group things. You remember? I mean, we cannot do the multiple alignment directly. We can do pairwise alignment and we calculate distance of pairs. And then we build a tree that says how to start. You put two together, then you add a new one. The order of alignment was given by a tree. That tree is usually built with this trick, okay? Oh, wait, something like that. So we join these two and the distance will be 17 half in one side, 17 half in the other. Okay? Any questions? No? Then, essentially, we are dropping these two elements and replacing with one. We join them together and we don't see A and B anymore. We see only the pair AB. So essentially we are going to drop this line and this one. These two they have to disappear. They have to be replaced by someone. So we drop two rows and two columns. Okay. And how we do that? Essentially the distance between the new element and the rest is the average. The distance that you had before, A to C, distance B to C, divided by 2, that is the updated value, okay? This is the key idea, and let's take a second to understand what's happening. We have two elements that are represented in the distance by two rows, and we are joining them together, and essentially we replace that two rows by the average, Let me go back one second.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Why we said, why we divide 17 into, it says 17.
Ah, because the distance between A and B is 17. So you have, okay, let me put it here. I'm sorry, here. Oh my gosh. Wait. Okay. You know the distance between A and B is 17. So I am putting AB in the middle. So one half here, one half here. The distance, the total distance is 17. And I'm putting this node in the middle.
Okay. I think each is 17.
No, it's the distance between A and B. And you are creating a new node that we don't have any reason for putting anywhere. It's somewhere in between. So we put in the half. Okay?
Okay.
Because what you want to keep is the distance between A and B has to be 17. Okay?
So we should look vertically or horizontally.
The same because the matrix is symmetrical. Therefore, if you look vertically or you look horizontally, you will get the same thing.
Okay.
The symmetry of the matrix gives you that. That is why when we mix two rows, we also have to mix two columns. You will, and here you have to take the average with 21 to 30, 31 to 34, and 23 to 21. And that is this formula. Okay? So it's an easy formula. You have the initial matrix and you make a new matrix, essentially grouping the two things together. In the first matrix, you choose the smallest value, and then you collapse these two rows and two columns into one new one. And you get a matrix like this, okay? The bold letters are the one that I changed, and the italics are the one that didn't change, okay? What is the smallest now? The smallest now is this one, okay? Then, we do the same trick again. We join A, B, and E, and we have 22 between A, B, and E, and one half in every side. By the way, that was a good question because I was also thinking that it should be the complete number, but then I had, when I was writing the slides, I found that, no, it has to be half. And then you repeat the same logic. You average ABE, is AB, the distance AB from the matrix, the second version of the matrix, and ABE here. And you get the new numbers here. And now the smallest is 28. So we join C and D. You get this one. And finally, you get the final distance here, 35, and you get this one. So this is the tree that we make with hierarchical clustering. Okay? Did you get the idea?
Yeah.
Yeah, I see that some people have cats. Some people even have birds. I will not say name, but I have. And that is coevolution, you know? If you have a cat, you know that they control you.
It's his playtime and he tries to make you get up and play with him.
So people can have dogs, but cats have people. Coevolution, my friend, coevolution. So, but let's think. So this is, just to give a name, this average linking, this is a weighted paired group method with arithmetical mean. That is the WPG. I mean, it's an awful name, but you have to see it because you will find it, okay? So before I go to the next one, just one question. Did you get the idea, no? That we start with the distance matrix that we take from the multiple alignment and the, oh my gosh, why is moving so much? I don't know what is happening here. I don't know what is happening here. Kind of the mouse get crazy. So, what we're saying is this. We start with a distance matrix, and we have a rule that said took the smallest one and then collapse, take the average, and then keep collapsing and taking the average. Okay. Now there is a problem here. You are making new matrix every time the matrix is smaller, so you are not, you know that this is going to finish one time. There is one problem that is not obvious, and to be honest, I didn't notice before, which is this. Here, when we are making this average here, we are mixing a group of two sequences with a group of three sequences. So somehow this sequence is less important than the ABE. ABE has three elements saying this is the truth, and this CD are two elements. So kind of you need to compensate for that. I mean, you can imagine that you have a tree that is very unbalanced, and you have in one side of the tree you have 100 sequences, and in the other you have one. And in this method, as I show, they are essentially equivalent. One sequence with 100 and one sequence with one. So even you, when you start here, you have two here and one here. And when we mix them, I'm taking the average of AB with E. So it's kind of, I'm taking half of A, half of B, and 100 of E. And then I'm taking half of C, half of D, half of E, and one quarter of A and B. So it's kind of unfair. The people who got joined together, the node that got joined together, have less weight in the total. So there is an alternative that is what people really use, the unweighted. By the way, that is what I'm carrying, that they when we mix them, they have different weight. This is one quarter, this is one half, or no, the, sorry, this is one quarter, one quarter, one quarter, one eighth each one in the total. So there is an alternative called unweighted paired group with arithmetic mean. Okay, arithmetic mean is average. No? And this final notation essentially say that you have to weight every part by the size of the group. In other words, when you take the average here, when you take the average, this is two and this is one. You put a compensation here. Two times this plus one divided by three. And then you have three times this plus two times this divided by five. You compensate by the size of the group, which is what says here. The distance from the group A multiplied by the size of A, the distance of the group B by the size of B, all divided by the total distance, the total number of elements. So at the first level, the formula is the same. The first iteration doesn't change. The second one, you get this 2 plus 1, the 3 that I was saying, so you get different numbers. For when you join A and B, these numbers are different now. And when we do the last joining, it's also different. So the topology doesn't change in this case. In this case, in some cases, the topology may change because the smallest numbers can be different. In this case, the topology doesn't change, but the weight changes. So, the first doesn't change, but in the highest level, you see this one, instead of being 6.5, and this is the original one. This is the weighted, this is the unweighted. So the 6.5 become 5.5. So here there is a small difference, but there is a difference, okay? Eventually, we can find another example when the differences are more marked. But The point is there are these two methods that they have the same philosophy, but they change the way that they combine different lines, and then they get different results. Okay, so I want to go to the next one, but the next one is a little different, so I suggest that we do the break now. I wanted to show these two together because they are very similar, and the next one is going to be different, so I suggest that we have the break now. Any problem with having break now? Let's go for coffee. So, well, I don't have many slides later, so, well, maybe we should do some practice later, but let's have, I don't know, how much, 15, 20 minutes? Say something.
Yeah, fine.
Fine what, 15 or 20?
20 is fine, I think.
Yeah, as I was saying, see. What can I say, pause? Okay. Let's make 20. Get your coffee. I don't know how to pause this thing. Pause share. No. Stop share. Stop share. That's what I want to say. Stop share. Okay. I have 10:40. Okay. Pause share. Oh, no. Why I don't find the thing that I want to find? Okay, we are back. By the way, you may notice that I didn't finish editing last week class, you know, it's been busy days. In fact, I have not yet finished your exam, so let's talk about the exam later, okay? Okay, I have just a couple of slides now. So it will not be too much. And then we should try to do some practice. Any question before we start? Yes, no. So you are clear, like essentially we say that we have all these methods start with the multiple alignment. You start with the, you have three methods, three general ideas, trying to minimize the number of chain, maximal parsimony, or trying to make the most probable one, assuming some kind of probabilistic model. And finally, method based on distance, that essentially we try to make the tree that using the distance between the sequences, forgetting about the sequence, just keeping the distance. And we have this problem. So you see the slides, no? We say that one problem is that it is not obvious that the distance between A and B is half and half. It's a little like a Turkan question, like why we have one half? Well, in the hierarchical modeling, we don't have any other information, and the model is not designed to solve that question. So people make a different approach. My idea is this. Let's say that you start here, and you have one mutation here, and essentially A diverged from B long time ago. And you can think like A is a different environment. So the organism A exposed to a different environment can have mutation rates that are different than B. Okay, and given different selective pressure, different environment, many reasons that you can have that some organism can have mutation at different rate. It's a question that, to be honest, I don't understand all the implications. So there is one vision that they call the molecular clock, like the mutation rate is proportional to the time. And at some level it is. I mean, at least in the short term, you don't have many mutations, and if you have a little more time, you start to have some mutation, but eventually things start to be different. And remember that the mutations that we see are the mutations that are accepted. That means that they depend on the environment. If the environment is very restrictive, you have many mutations that are lethal. If the environment is more generous, you can have many mutations and they will not be lethal, and you will see them. You have more variety. I mean, how many animals you see in the jungle, how many animals you see in the desert. There are a few plants that grow in the desert, and in the jungle, when you have abundance of water and abundance of sun, you can do anything that you want. So, how they solve? So one vision, let's say very mathematical, let me play my mathematical side here, is this. You know the tree, and you know the distance, and you want to put the distance. I probably should do an explanation, a graphic for this, but the general idea is that you want to find this distance, the small d, at the distance in the tree, that are the most similar to the distance that you observe in the matrix. This big D is the matrix that we built before, and this big D is the matrix, and the small d is the distance you get from the tree. So if you have the shape, you can essentially find the distance solving this problem, which it's a little work, but it's not, I mean, it's hard to do. I mean, it's not hard, but it takes time to do, but it's a very straightforward. This is the kind of problem that computers are very good at solving. So what I mean is that if you give me the tree, I can find the distance that in the tree that are more closer to the distance in the matrix. That is something that is not hard to do. It's very straightforward. But you need to know the topology. So there is another method that is what I see that people recommend, that we will see, is called neighbor joining. One of the most recommended. There is another, but let's just focus on this one. And the basic idea is this. In the previous method, we joined the element that looked closer in the matrix, but somehow it can happen that the one that are closer in the matrix are not the one that are closer evolutively. There is an idea that how close you are, it depends on not only on the distance between A and B, but also the distance to everybody else. So they have this kind of normalization that I will try to give you the idea of this. So we have initially the distance between A and J, the two nodes, and we want to somehow compare I with everybody else and J with everybody else. Okay? So it's kind of, let's say that if I is very popular, if I is connected to everybody, it's very close to everybody, then being close to J is not a big thing because it's close to everybody. So you want to compensate this distance between A and J essentially by comparing to everybody else. And the same with J. It's a kind of normalization. It's kind of, if you are very close to everybody, then this will normalize. If you are very distant to everybody, then this will also normalize. And I have an idea. This here, if you see, we are summing over all values, all the elements in the network, and eventually you will have ij here. That is essentially one more time here and ij here. So you are counting the ij twice. So you have n times here. So there is a kind of, this is n minus two that I think, I'm not sure, but I think this comes from the fact that you are counting it here and you're also counting it here. Well, the point is that the neighbor joining idea is that instead of looking directly at the distance matrix, you build another matrix, this Q, with a number that tend to be negative. This can be negative. This is not a distance. It's a different thing, but the philosophy is the same. We will look at the smallest one and we join the smallest one. And this, I mean, I didn't have the illustration. I mean, we can follow the same exercise, but I didn't do it. So it can be a nice exam question. So you will build something like this. You start essentially with all the elements, and you when you do neighbor joining, you build a graph like this. And let me show you a couple of important points here. First, you see neighbor joining produce unrooted trees. With the hierarchical clustering, it's kind of natural to see it like rooted trees. Here we have them unrooted. Second, the length between the old nodes and the new ones are not equal. It is not split in half. So for example, here FU is longer than GU. Here, when we join A with the previous two, there is a short and a long one. And the reason for that is because they are trying to solve the problem that I say. They are trying to solve like the length from A to G should be very similar to the one that we have in the matrix, the distance in the tree at the end, the distance between A and G, the distance between C and F. Considering all these steps in between, should be very similar, the most similar possible to the distance in the matrix. So the idea of neighbor joining is this. You try to find a topology and a distance of branches that make the distance in the tree the most similar possible to the distance in the matrix, the distance that we get from the multiple alignment. So if you try to do both together, it's a big problem. So neighbor joining is a kind of shortcut. It's an heuristic that allow you to build the network and assign the length at the same time in a more or less efficient way. It's an heuristic, of course, you have a trade-off, but it's something that people in general trust that they will be good. Now, maybe the point that I should say with more detail that you may have in some cases more than one solution. So with the same data, you may have a little different. So what people do, they kind of took the same sequences and they kind of redo it again. They change the order. They kind of perturbate the scale. You start from the initial problem. You change a little bit to see if the three are still the same, even if you change a little, some small mutation, and you see what happened. So you may see that people do what is called bootstrapping. Bootstrapping is essentially like, I'm going to do it again, but just changing a little bit the initial data to see if the results are the same. So I don't have the matrix here, and it will be very much the same before. And I'm not sure if how much we need to do, because to be honest, in real life, we don't do this by hand. Maybe we can have an exercise that will be useful to do manually, like taking the matrix that I give you and doing the exercise. But I think it's for your case, it's more important to use them and know what is the difference. So neighbor joining, in contrast to the hierarchical clustering, give you an unrooted tree and give you different length in different branches. Okay, if you have an outgroup, you can find the root and make it a rooted tree, but the tree will be much more interesting. So what I want to do now, after the last two slides, is make an exercise. Okay, make an exercise like, let's find a sequence and let's find some website let's find what we can do now with real sequences. Okay. Any questions so far? So I know that I'm not giving you too much detail about this one, and the one that I know is the best one, the one that I recommend, but let's try to do a practical exercise. Okay, there is one last thing that I have to tell you that is important, is about the that the distance, the number of mutations is not time. Well, first we know that the mutation rate can be different in different environments. But the real problem is this. When you start mutating, you can have, okay, what happened here? Ah, yeah, here. That you change, this is the initial sequence. And here I should put some color maybe. But you change a letter, like you have this T in this column become G. Can you see I put in color the letter? T becomes G. And then in another event, it becomes T again. That can happen. I mean, if you have mutation, you can have two mutations in line and then they become the same letter. So, okay, maybe I am doing it too much, but you see from the initial sequence and the last sequence are the same. Okay, maybe let me be more clear. The first sequence is the initial organism. Then here we have one mutation. This is this G. Then you have another mutation that undo the G. Then you have another mutation that change this T to an A. Then you have another mutation that gives back the same. So the final organism and the initial organism have the same sequence. Nevertheless, if you have a time machine, you will see that they are five. Here you have one mutation, second, third, fourth. You have four mutations and you don't see them. Why this happened? Let me show you this. To understand this, I make a little simulation, something that we can do. I mean, it's a tool in R, something that you can do eventually. And I did this. I took a sequence in this case. Well, I took a random sequence of DNA of four letters. I took one random, and then I start mutating randomly. So every step here in the horizontal is one mutation. And then I compare the result with the original one. So first, the initial distance is zero because it's the original one. Then you have one mutation, two mutations, and interestingly, this is real simulation. No? I this is made with the computer simulating a random. The mutation here in between the second and the third, you change a letter by the same one. It is still a mutation, but it doesn't look well. Maybe it's not a mutation if you keep the same one. The point is that you start mutating, and when you get some level that is essentially the 75%, what happens is that you have so many mutations that there is a very high chance that the next mutation that you do will make it closer to the original one. I mean, essentially, you cannot be 100% different because you keep mutating and you keep going back to the original one. You can repeat the simulation again and again, and it's something that you can even prove mathematically that when time happens, you reach some kind of plateau. You can have some variability, but in the long term, you see, we go around this 75%. 75% is essentially because we have four letters, and each one has a 25% of probability. So this 25% is here. What I mean, if we have if instead of DNA we have protein, the top will be 95% in the case of protein, because you have 20 letters, and the probability of getting the same is 1 in 20. Here we have 1 in 4 probability of getting the same letter as the original one. That is why we essentially, after all the mutation, we get to a maximum. Okay. You see what is happening? Any question here? That has another consequence. It's like if you take two random sequences.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Can you repeat why it's 75%?
Well, I am giving you kind of an intuition idea, but if you choose any letter randomly, there is 1 in 4 chance of finding the same letter that you had in the original sequence. Okay?
Yeah.
So that is basically the idea. So you have 1 in 3 that you will be different, and 3 in 4 that you are going to be different, and 1 in 4 that you are going to be the same. So when you mutate a lot the sequence, when there is a lot of mutation, you will start to get a point that when you get more or less that 75% of difference, then there is the highest probability that the letter that you change will make it to go closer to the original sequence. It is kind of hard to change something and try to make it much different because, they are all different. And I mean, 75% of them are different. If you choose any one of the different and of the letter that are mutated and you change it back, you will get closer to the original sequence. Okay, let me try to explain a different way. When you start with the original sequence, anything that you change will be bad. Okay, here at the beginning, anything that you change will be bad. And you keep getting worse and worse, more and more mutations, you get worse. But there is a moment that you have so much letters that are different from the original one that if you change them, there is a good chance that you are going to improve and you start seeing this, that the distance is going to reduce. Then they can go worse. Then, I mean, if you improve, then you can get worse. But if you are too bad, you have the tendency to go back to the good one. So you have this oscillation around the average, but they move around the average. And here, to make this, I choose a short sequence. If the sequence are long, this variability is even smaller. So essentially, the intuition is like, if you make too many mistakes, you will start to make something good, essentially because you are wrong at being wrong, let's say. It's a mutation of the mutation that is, you are mutating so much that you are going back to the original one. And in this case, the limit is more or less like when you get to 75%, but because you can have 3 bad of every 4. And if you start to have more, then you start going back. Maybe we can later, when we study the probability, we can try to see it again. So just to give an anticipation, what I'm looking for, what is this? I'm going to give you an exam today, and you are going to be thinking about this exam for the next weeks. When we come back, I want to speak about DNA assembly. That is still more or less the same philosophy. It's a different word, but it's the same philosophy. And it will not interfere very much with your mind that you will have the exam. But when you finish the exam, that will be like in 3 weeks, more or less. Then I want to start speaking about probabilities. I want to go a little more mathematical because I will have shown most of the tools that we can use, and the rest to understand the result. What I think is that you need the language of probabilities. So what I'm looking forward is that we will speak for, I don't know, 3 weeks about probabilities and a little more like theoretical background. Because I mean, at least I want I would like to convince you that to understand why this is happening, you need to understand a little bit about probabilities. If you need to understand what is the E value, you need to understand the probabilities. If you want to know the maximum likelihood, you need to understand probabilities. So, of course, not that you are going to be a probabilistic expert, but you will have the language, because it's kind of the language that you need to use here, okay? It's not necessarily that you are going to be calculating the probabilities, but you should have enough intuition of what is happening here. Okay, so that is the second part of the course. DNA assembly, genome assembly, probabilities. And in probability, one good application is a primer design. Okay, it's something about that. So yeah, we can take a look at this again later. The basic idea for now is that there is a saturation level. Given, again, an hypothesis about the probabilities, you get some saturation level. Of course, here I am assuming that the four nucleotides have the same chance. In some cases, it may not be the case. In some cases, you will have a GC content that is different and this number may change. Also, I am assuming that changing one letter by another is the same chance. And in practice, like put-ins by put-ins are more probable that put into pyramids, their kind of not all substitutions are the same. The point is that for do the complete analysis, one of the questions that we'll ask you is the substitution model. And what you need to know is that there are several, and the simple one that the people talk is called Jux-Cantor, is old one from the 60s. Imagine how old. And it is the formula like this: is you have this the mismatch is the percentage of mismatch. It's essentially this value here, mismatch in terms of percentage. And since the maximum here is 3/4, they multiply by 4/3 to get a number between 0 and 1. And this is the correction factor. You will get 1 minus that number. The more higher this number, this difference is going to be smaller and the logarithm is going to be more infinite. So essentially what I'm showing you here, it's a line, we can try to do it, but it's a line that will eventually match this. It's kind of a regression through here. We can try to make it. And that is built based on some theoretical ideas on the substitution rate. And the keyword is Jux-Cantor, and you can Google it and learn more if you want. And there are other models. So I'm just giving you kind of the keywords. So the minimum thing that we should be able to do is do neighbor joining and using a substitution model like Jux-Cantor. There are others. There is another method that I didn't include here for building trees, but we will find if we do something practical. So I will ask if you have a question, but just to make a summary, what I want to do now is to use the protein sequence that we have. We can do with DNA, but let's do with protein just because we had something last week. You remember they give you some dihedrin proteins, and we did a multiple alignment, and we should find some tools and try to do this in practice. Okay? Any question? Do you have the proteins? No, the point here is that I have not done anything of this. So I was thinking the tools that we have here are, you probably should look like, but there is some kind of famous tools, kind of Philip is one of the famous one. Then there is other called Mr. Bayes. Okay, using a different model. I don't know if they have an online version. No. Maybe this phylogeny.france. FASTA, Philip Klose. Okay, so here, if you see, you have to upload the alignment. So you have to do the alignment first. I didn't save the alignment last week, did we? No, but anyway, the point is that we should start doing the, okay, alignment. Muscle was a multiple alignment. Then there is a correlation that I don't know what it is. Then phylogeny, and then drawing the tree. Okay? You see this plot here. So my proposal is that we do this in parallel, in the sense that you find other tools. Find if you can find other tools. Maybe in NCBI we have also multiple alignment. No? Do we have? Multiple sequence alignment. There is a viewer. Okay, multiple alignment tool, something called Cobalt. My point is that in real life, you are going to do something like this. If you get a problem that requires to make a phylogenetic tree, you will get sequence that the one that I gave you last week. Do you have the sequence? This daydream? Yes, no, maybe.
BHN3 file?
Yes.
Exactly.
Yeah, we have.
Yeah, that's the one. So we can choose a file. What I have.
We did a guide tree last week.
No, with last week we did the alignment. We opened Clustal.
Yeah, it was a guide tree. And you said
yes.
It's not a phylogenetic tree.
Exactly. That is the kind of the important thing, that the phylogenetic tree is not the guide tree. Remember that what they do, the guide tree is you do alignment of pairs, A with B, A with C, all combination of pairs. And you calculate the distance with this pair alignment, and you make a matrix, and then they make the hierarchical clustering, and that gives you a tree. But that tree is not looking at the full picture. It's looking pairs to pair. And after you do the multiple alignment, you may find that you get new gaps, or you do an alignment in a different way. So in general, the matrix of distance that you get after the multiple alignment is different from the matrix that you get before the multiple alignment, okay? So this guide tree, is just to make the alignment, but it's not a phylogenetic tree. Most of this program give you the alignment tree and a phylogenetic tree together. So, daydream we can do. So my proposal is choose different tools, and we start with the same sequence, and we choose different tools, and we see if we get something similar or different, and what are the questions, and if we get things. One of the points here, the form output format that I didn't find how to change later. That is unfortunate. But we saw the Clustal W format is kind of very common, but there is another called Philip, that is the one of this software, Philip, no? Somebody was saying that we use old thing. This is even looking old, you know, the look of the web pages look like 90s. And this is, in fact, an old program, but it's still being updated. So these are old but new. in the sense that they had the first version 30 years ago or 20 years ago. No, 30 years ago. But they are still being used, still being updated. So they are old. No, they are new with experience. They are new programs and they have been new for many years. This even have Windows version. So one of the problem is that you not always find it online. There is not a web version, so you have to download. For example, this you can download for Windows or for Mac and run in your computer. That is the kind of typical thing that you will have, that since this use a lot of resources, people don't want to put them online. They say, okay, if you want to do it on your own computer. The same was here, if you saw with the, what was the other software, the Philip was one, you have to download, what was the other? Mr. Bias, that was also. You go to Mr. Bias, you see that there is not a kind of an online version. So you have to, you can use in your computer. So there is not web application, you have to download. So you can try this one, or let's try something online. Here is a French website. Where is it? People in Lyon, if I'm not. I'm going to try. Let's say overview. User input, you align with a tool called Muscle. Then there's a curation that we have to learn, Phylogeny with PhilML, that have also different options. And the tree will also, there will be a file with a different format, and then you have a different tool to visualize it. Maybe we should learn about that. But you kind of need this pipeline of tools. You have to do an alignment, you have different tools. The proposed one, but you can use another one. The important thing is that your output here should be in a format that the next one uses. Then Phylogeny, you will also have different tools. And if you, let me show you back. When we see here, they say, look, we can do it for you, but you have to give me the alignment, upload your alignment. So you align and you give it to me. And then I will make you a tree. And then showing the tree is another tool. So you have this, pipeline of tools, and you can choose different alignment tools, you can choose different phylogenetic tools, and you can choose different tree visualization tools. They have the same philosophy, but everyone is different. Okay. Let's try something. So I will choose the file. I have to remember where I put my file. And please do your same, you know, DHN.
Is Muscle tool for the alignment is just a preference or?
And I'm just, because I choose this website, and this website is, that is kind of the default in this website. No, but that's why I say try different website. If you go to NCBI, there is something called Cobalt, which I don't know how they do, but essentially you put sequence here and give you a multiple stake alignment and with some criteria. We can try here, let's try, why not? Line, okay, what are the parameters here? Gap penalties, end gap is outside, no? And word size. So this is kind of a blast-based multiple alignment. Let's see what happens. And we have this one. I choose the file here. And I will skip this git block because I don't want to make it harder. And I will put my email in case it takes time. Okay, so we have to wait. Let's see this. Okay, Cobalt, give me this thing. So let's try something. First, these are the sequence that we got, and they are very similar. You remember we saw this. So let's see what we can download here. We can download the FASTA alignment, just in case we need it later. Let me see if we can show it. What you have to know for practical life is that there are different formats for this. One is directly the FASTA. Let me open it for you. But it's a kind of a FASTA with gaps, which is kind of funny. One second. Download and the query here. Okay, and I open with the text editor. Ah, and I have to share the editor with you. Okay, let me share this one. Okay. Not very bad. Sharing the screen, this one. Okay. Share. Yeah, good. So these are essentially the same sequence that I give you, but the difference is that this time there is gaps here. Okay. So kind of the simple output format for an alignment is FASTA with gaps.
I'm sorry, but I think I missed how you opened this.
Ah, yeah, I didn't show you because it's a particular thing that I do in my computer. I have a text editor. Essentially, you go to your favorite text editor and you say open. Let me show you. But what I can show you is that, let me repeat the step then. What I did was essentially, I went in the NCBI and I got this message, this window, and it say download, and I click download, okay? And when saying download, they had two options. One was the FASTA alignment, and the other, this printer-friendly PDF that you can choose here. SVG is a similar format vector, high quality. This is kind of the thing that you download to print, maybe. Why not? And this gets started in my computer, no? So cancel. Done. I'm ready. Closing here. So after I did this, I get the files here in my download folder here. I got this, and the alignment is this ALN. And what I did essentially was to take this and drop into my editor. And open with the text editor. You remember a tool that I always insist that you have to do, and I think I say a tool that we need is a text editor. The best ones is probably Atom or Visual Studio Code. There are others like Notepad or Sublime Text or things like that. There are pros and cons. I mean, in general, text editors are, they take some time to learn, but they are kind of the super powerful tool because all the things that you are going to get, or most of the things that you're going to get in real life are text files, and you need a way to see the text file. And in Windows, it's not natural. This in Mac and Linux is very easy to see text file, but in Windows not so easy. So you have you need a tool. And essentially, my point is here: what we got is simply a FASTA, very similar to the one that I give you, except that there's gaps that they were not in the first version. Okay. How I open, it depends on how you do in your computer. I use one text editor. Fine?
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, good question. So that is part of the person. Ah, let's see the PDF since we are here. What is the PDF? You have to know that I didn't use this tool before, so I know as much as you. I am exploring with you. So let's make it. It look like this. Let's say full screen. No. Okay, maybe not so much full screen. Maybe something. Okay, this one. You see, it's something that is, well, we have to put names eventually here, if you like, and it's a kind of visual representation, graphical. Something that you may put in a paper or a report or some, or an exam answer or something like that. Okay, nothing to get crazy, but let's go to the real thing. We got this FASTA, and that FASTA is the one that we should be able to put here. It says, okay, this is working here. Let's see if we got this here. Okay, this is one result. Let's see if I can do another one.
I think I got a different result. The numbers change.
And that will be great that we can compare. One second. Okay, this is the pipeline here, no? With one alignment. Here, we use a different alignment, and they may be different. So. And what we got here, we got the data that we saved, then this is the sequence, then we went to the alignment that they made. The gaps that we have and mismatches that we have, okay? These sequences are very similar, so probably all the alignment tool will give something similar. Then the phylogeny is here. And we can see, let's see, you will get the different format here, okay? There's a funny text here. And okay, let me show you this one. Okay, do you remember that this is one of the format for trees? It's a text file and with a lot of parentheses. So everything that is parentheses is connected, and then the number that came after is the distance. So this is obviously for the computer, but the point is that you can take this Newick format and put in with a tree rendering, a different tool that will give you something nicer. Let's see it here, and then we compare with a MET result because, yeah, I want to know what is different. And here you can download in different format. I don't know what is this one. And here you have something. Okay, what we can say, midpod rotating collapse branches. Okay, here the branch length correspond to the distance, no? And you see here the distance are symmetrical in both sides. This is short, this is long. Kind of essentially they say that this K102 is ancestor of these two ones. Okay, phylogram, cladogram, let's see what happened if I do here updating. Ugly. Cladogram is the one that doesn't show the kind of pyramid. Let's say radial. Here is kind of more kind of an unrooted one. So here it's more clear that these two sequences are descending from this K12, and the others are kind of a common ancestor. If we have an out group, we can change. We should have an out group here. No? What else? Another level, a circular. You can have different graphic. This is probably the. Oh my gosh, this is very ugly. No. Yeah. I mean, to me, the most clear was this one. This one. To me, this was the most clear. What is your result, Ahmed? Can you share your screen or not?
Yeah, sure. I can share my screen.
Let's see. I'm stop sharing. So maybe the point is that you have many options, and the result, if you are unlucky, the result will be interesting. The result will be different depending on some option that you get. So
I was talking, but I wasn't on mute. Sorry. The numbers are similar, yeah. But
yeah.
They're not exactly the same.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, the shape is the same. And probably yes. The shape is the most important part here.
How do the numbers change? We use the same input.
I don't know. I know that some of these methods, since they are heuristics, there is some heuristic in some part, then they have some part that is random, and essentially they will not give you exactly the same number, but they give you similar numbers if you run it again. So maybe there is something in the tool. So what can we do here? Let's see. In the alignment, do we have any options here? Well, what I want to try is if I want to upload the other, and you get different thing.
I can change the outputs maybe. If that makes...
I know you get the same here. What taxon associated, unload taxon name. We don't have Java applet because they don't work anything more. No, fine.
What's this I, by the way? I don't know what's I or A or R.
Well, these are all amino acids, and I think they are showing it in lowercase. They are showing in lowercase when they are kind of more different, I guess.
Okay.
Do we have any option here? Well, the only option that we have here is to use a different alignment using the alignment from Cobalt or something like that.
Yeah, we can upload our own alignment, no?
Yeah. In the phylogeny, do we have any option? The visualization and the statistic? No, we don't have. Okay, let me try.
Should I try this one?
No, because that is probably going to give you something similar to the tree rendering. You will have different tools. So,
maybe we can try different alignment tool.
Exactly.
I tried to use KeenBL, but it's a long way to. Do you see it? I have to download several.
Yeah, exactly. You have to. That was the point, that you need to do a different. What was the name? You have to install in your computer, exactly. You have to install in your computer.
Yes.
Yeah, and that will take time. So, but my point is this. For today, for the class, for the practice, we don't need to do everything. But In your real life, if you one day you need to do this, like in your final project or in your next life you need to do, it is good to know that there's something that you can download in your computer and make it run. Depending on the size of the project, it can take some hours or sometimes some days to work. So you leave your computer working and you go to drink coffee or sleep or... By the way, that is why I have my desktop computer in the office. I have the notebook that I use for the class, but all my kind of computational part is done in the desktop, okay? You need something to be working in the background. So let me share the screen now. Let's see if I can do something different. So. We were working with Philip, but I went back to this Mr. Base, which is a different approach, and they say upload your alignment. So here I'm going to choose the file that NCBI give us. So I am aligning with Cobalt, and I am uploading this Cobalt alignment in FASTA format. This is protein, and okay. What are the number of substitution types? What is this? Ah, yeah, look. Let me make it a little larger. So what I'm doing here is this. I am doing the phylogeny again. Here for this tool called Mr. Base, the input is an alignment. The alignment that I'm taking is the one given by Cobalt. Cobalt is the NCBI tool. I put our sequence and I download the alignment, okay? Which was the file that I show you, this one, okay? This is the result. It's kind of very easy because the sequences are very similar, but with some gaps. I am entering this here. Well, here, no, close this one, here. I put that alignment here. Then this tool, Mr. Bay, has some this is a maximum likelihood method. And there's some parameters that we have to choose. So let me choose the one that are kind of easy to understand. Number of substitution types. This JC69 means Jux-Cantor 69. This is about the correction between substitutions and distance, okay? Here you choose the time. So you have Jux-Cantor or different models. This code, eventually people learn them. I can search and give you more detail later, but I know that this GC69 means this Jux-Cantor 1969. Then the different logic of substitution, in this case, DAFOV and Blossom are the matrix that we know, but there are other based on different hypotheses. No rate variation, I'm going to make it easy. But you see the different thing that we need to understand, unfortunately, we need to understand more probabilities before going to the detail. This is a simulation that they have. Monte Carlo essentially means it's a simulation, and I'm going to make it small so to make it faster. No, Sumaris, something like that. I don't know how long it's going to take, so I will put my email again. In other words, I put the small one. Okay. This can take time. So, in other words, if let's say you have an exam and in the exam say do a multiple alignment, try to do it soon. Okay, because it can take some time. While this is running, I'm going to say what I the question that you are not asking about the exam. I have not written the exam yet, except the question that you already answered. But my idea is this. I want to have like three questions, maybe four, but like choose three or four, something like that. You already did one. So I want to give you three questions, okay? And I probably, depending on the question, because we'll see the complexity, but my idea is that I give you three questions and you choose two of them, okay? So you have some flexibility on that. And the questions, I want to make something like, this is the problem. Well, probably one is going to be like this multiple alignment, okay? I want to give you some sequence. I'm going to simulate some evolution. I'm going to make 10 or 15 sequences, maybe, yeah, was 10 or 15 sequences of DNA generating randomly with mutations that I know. So I will know the tree, okay? I will know the original tree. And you use a tool like this. It's an exercise like this. This will be one of the questions. And the other questions, I have a couple of ideas for questions about like looking in database or using BLAST. And I think there are two parts. One is like, let's say strategy question. Like, okay, how you find, I don't know, the solution. I will ask you a question, I will tell you, what is the strategy? If you are the boss, what will you tell to your student to do? You will say, do BLAST with this and these options. So what I mean is that 70% of the grades. Good.
Sorry.
You okay? Some of the, what was I saying? Okay, 70% of the grade for that question will be to tell what to do. In other words, you don't need computer. You need to say, okay, this problem, the approach will be doing this blast and then combining this way, something like that. Okay, how to process the rest, what kind of question you ask, what kind of option you choose, and how to. And then the last 30% will be doing it. So if you have time and you have computer time, you do the BLAST and you do the computational part and you do the processing. But the most important part, in my opinion, is knowing what to do. Okay, having a plan. Okay, you understand? You got my idea?
Yeah, but I have a question.
Okay.
Seems as open-ended questions.
Of course, this is a homework. You have, of course, everything is. I always ask open-ended questions. Always.
No, I know that, but the things you said. How will we use the system to upload or something? Because I think I know that we can load just one file.
Ah, no, yeah, okay, no, how will the answer? No, of course, my point, your answer is a document, a Word or Markdown, something that you write, like, okay, question, your name, your date, something, and you write, okay, for question number one, the answer is this, and you put the text that you wrote. For question number two, the answer is this. For question number four, because they say that you choose to skip question number two. Guess what?
My microphone is open.
So you just write in Word, okay? Or well, I don't.
Yeah, but if we use BLAST and like do practical, we won't.
Yeah, yeah. I mean the practical is you do the BLAST and you copy and paste the result and you put in your report.
Okay, I got
it. So the report, yeah?
We're not gonna send the alignment file. We are just gonna write.
I don't know yet. I don't have the alignment file, but I think that you can do, I mean, if I can do the alignment, you can also do it, no? I will give you a FASTA or something like that. And you choose one of the tools, and you should, I mean, just.
And my concern is that we have limited space to upload files and write type the answers. That's my concern. Maybe it won't be enough.
Bioinformatics is homework.
Yeah. Yeah.
It says open-ended.
No, it's a homework. I checked it.
I took that earlier. It's the Turkish version of the class. That's open-ended.
Is the dates are the same with the Turkish one?
Nope.
We have no date yet.
It's 25 of December.
25.
Really?
Really? So the, my advice is this. Well, I have to write it. I have not written that. But you already have one question advanced because you started working on this. Then, by the way, before I forget, please write your student number now in the chat, okay? Before I forget, please write your student number. Thank you. So, you already have one question that you are that you can answer that you are working, and it will be part of the report. The second, you read the questions and try to understand it soon. I know that you will be working in other exams, so it is fine if you do it after. I mean, you have something that is more urgent. But my advice is start thinking about this early. Let me stop sharing. Start thinking about the problem early, okay? So because it will be in your mind, it will be in the background. You are doing other things, you are not thinking about that, but somewhere in your brain is going to be working. If you don't do this, if you wait until the last minute, it will be bad for you because kind of you will have too much stress, too much pressure. That is the way the brain works, you know. You kind of get a first idea and then you do something else and the brain is kind of chewing, like pre-digesting, you know, pre-processing, pre-washing, if you like. You know, when you put dirty clothes in the washing machine, you put in water for all the night before washing. That is the same idea. You put in the water in your brain and you pre-wash it, okay? And then when you have time, you apply. But it will be, in general, it's much better because you kind of already pre-processed the idea. You ask the question soon. You find something weird in the exam, you ask the question soon. And then when you finish the other exam and you have time, you answer. Now, if you have, let's say, in total three questions, you work one question in one day, only one question. Okay, you decide, but I think the best is like, okay, today I'm going to work in question number one. I'm going to finish the report. Okay, you finish it. And then you do something else. Then next time you take question number two, you focus on only one question and you do something else. Because if you are doing kind of all at the same time, it will be kind of hard. So I hope that in 3 weeks, you have enough time to find 3 days in 3 weeks, no? Yes, no? I hope. Well, that is the exam. Let's see what's happening here. We have 10 minutes, but just to finish the idea. Phylogeny, this one give... there is an issue with the names here. If you
there's a question on the chat also says, for example.
Okay. We have a homework. Yes, a homework. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, lady. Yes, ma'am. It's a homework. Yeah. In general, I prefer homeworks because I think it's more realistic. I also think that normally we are not running against time. I don't want to measure your memory. I want to measure your reasoning. I mean, I don't want you to be working 3 weeks on this, but I don't want you to be doing in the last hour, you know? I don't want to give you 90 minutes. I want to give you more time. So I hope that this can be solved in, I don't know, one day in total, like 2 hours, one question, 2 hours, one question, maybe less, maybe 1 hour each question. I hope it doesn't take you too much time, but I don't want you to be running, okay? I want if a parsimonious like, response.
If it's 25th of December, our exams are finishing at 17th, so we have a lot of time.
Yeah, but the problem is that the real exercise here is that people, including me, we are bad at managing time. So we say, I have a lot of time. I will do it later. I will do it later. Did I tell you that I used to live very close to my workplace? Many years ago, I was living in front of the university. And I was late every day because it was so close that I don't know. Time management. The hidden exercise here is time management. Start soon and manage your time. Assign some time. Are we sharing the screen? Yes. There is one problem here that I probably need to do it again. Is that the sequence have different names. When I put the sequence in BLAST, you see the names are not very useful. It's query one, query two, query three. There is something that I should have done more careful. Yeah. The FASTA should have been something like this, something more clear. I don't know. In fact, there is a lesson here that is go beyond my error. One of the typical problems, and this is silly, but it's a typical problem is that in BLAST, we tend to get very long names for the sequence. And in the phylogenetic analysis and multiple analysis, most of the tools want names that are short. So if you have one of the typical problems that people has is exactly what I'm doing here, is try to correct the sequence name. So be careful with that. Be careful that the name of the sequence are kind of tricky. Okay, something like that. So, going back to the point here, just to finish the idea, we got this Mr. Bayer, the names, we have to fix them again. The tree looks kind of similar. And we have this clade. And then you have, they have a credibility value, how much you believe in this branch. And then here you have things based on different length. And I guess that you can go and visualize it. We don't load the tree here in the NewIQ format. And I will copy this one. And I will go back to this thing that was something like tree viewer. This one. This was the tree viewer that we had before. And I will paste the file, the NewIQ files here and see what happened. And let's see, we get a drawing. Yeah. No. This is. Okay. What is the result? Coming. Yeah. Okay. This is a different tree. This is different for basically because the tool that we use for is was different. Okay, first the alignment was different, maybe not very different, but the main difference is that instead of using the Philip that we used before, I use Philip. Instead of using this tool, Philip, I use this tool, Mr. Bayes. which is a different phylogenetic tree. So from the same, or more or less the same alignment, I use different tools and I get different trees here. So, well, a question is how they compare. One of the things that you will notice here is that the tree is different, the shape of the tree is different, and the length of the branch are different. So, well, let's see. These are the branch lengths. And you see the branch can have different lengths. Okay.
How should we read this tree?
Okay, maybe, well, to be honest, the first thing that we should have here is an outgroup to be able to have a good root. But my idea, what I understood better is what this radial tree, something like this. The second thing, I should change the name. The names of the sequence should be the original names. I make a mistake when I use NCBI and I lost the original names. But after you fix them, the way that we read is what is this? 80%, and do we have names here? But essentially, you put the distance here and you essentially get, how can we read? The distance, the phylogenetic distance. Essentially, the what I understand here is here. All these sequences around here came from a common ancestor, and they are kind of independent. But these two ones are not independent. These two ones are descendant of this one. Okay. Okay, this is kind of boring because they are all kind of independent. But if we are lucky, the simulation that we are going to do for the exam is going to be nicer, a tree more elaborated. This exercise is kind of tricky because remember the sequences that we started using are very similar, so there are not many surprises here. So next time I'm going to choose something more distant. Okay. Well, if you don't have any question, I have a lot of questions. So ask your question. I may not be able to answer them, but I am not an expert on this. I am learning with you. But essentially what I know is that these are tools that people use. I don't use them, so I'm not an expert. And I am showing you the tools that the people I know tell me they use. They tell me that they use Mr. Bias or neighbor joining, and they use the different kind of drawings, and they use Klustal or similar for alignment. So remember, for alignment, the tools that we mostly use are Klustal or Mosel. And there was another, but it was last week. So first you do the multiple alignment, and with that alignment, you go to a different tool for doing the phylogenetic tree. And that can be a neighbor joining, Philippe in fact has many options, including neighbor joining and parsimonious and things like that. And or Mr. Bayes, which is one using what we say maximum likelihood, is a likelihood method. They will give you a tree in this kind of weird format. What is it here? In this, they give you a tree in this weird format that is a text file, and then you took a different tool for drawing, like this 3D. Or there are several tools that take the text file and give you a drawing. So separate tools that you use, and you can have different combinations, something like that.